The story begins with the memory of a woman named Louise Banks with her daughter, Hannah. Louise Banks is an expert in linguistics, which is the science of language. That day she came to a college where she used to teach as a lecturer.
Portuguese, and why it sounds so different from the other romance language.
In the midst of teaching activities, all of the students suddenly receive an emergency message from the government on their cell phones. They ask Louise to immediately open the news channel using the classroom projector screen. Then they were all shocked by the news of the landing of unknown spaceships in several parts of the world. This incident caused the government to declare a state of emergency. The classes were dismissed and all students were asked to go home. The situation looks not conducive because people are starting to panic. The sky was filled with American military jets passing by.
Sir, class is dismissed. From Earth, we're still collecting information. We're coordinating with other countries.
The next day, Louise returned to the college to teach as usual. But when she got there, she didn't find anyone. Apparently, teaching activities were still closed that day. Then she went into a room to see the news about the progress of yesterday's incident.
New gun licenses forcing panic buying of gas, water, and food continues to escalate.
Suddenly, she was approached by several members of the American military. One of them was their leader, Colonel Weber. Weber mentioned Louise's track record, who had contributed to helping the American military, translating the language in a video from Persian rebel group. According to him, Louise is the most skilled person in the field of linguistics. But this time she was asked to translate a language she had never heard of. Weber showed her a voice recording. Louise was confused for a moment. She asked, what was that song? According to Louise, it was very difficult for her to translate just from the voice, because it was something she was completely unfamiliar with. She needs direct interaction. In the early morning, Louise was surprised by an American military helicopter that landed right in her yard. It turned out to be Weber. He picked up Louise and made her a member of the Alien Research Team for America.
Pack your bags.
On the plane, she was introduced to a physicist named Ian Donnelly. They arrived at the Alien Research Center for America, which was only a few hundred meters from the unknown spacecraft. The shape of the spaceship at first glance looked like flat stone floating in the air. Underneath there is a door that will open every 18 hours. Louise and Ian were both amazed, but worried at the same time. Then they are brought in by members of the military to carry out medical check-up procedures before starting their research assignment. After completing the procedures, they were taken to a room where virtual communication from several research camps around the world was conducted. Representatives from Australia reported that the plane had its own gravity and air circulation, which could vary at any given time. Ian said there could be two possibilities. First, it might be a form of their adaptation to Earth. And second, maybe they want to see, to interact with them. Soon Colonel Weber came to escort Louise and Ian to the post where they would be assigned. Weber explained that the task of both of them is as soon as possible to get answers to some of the main questions. Namely, what do they want? Where did they come from? And why are they here? Then Louise and Ian were asked to immediately prepare themselves. The time had come to enter the ship and begin their first interaction with the aliens. Although the researchers revealed that the plane contained air that was safe for humans, they were asked to use hazmat to enter it, in order to minimize the risk of exposure to certain radiation. With hydraulic ladders, they slowly entered the plane. As the researchers said, the ship has its own gravity system, making them seem to be stepping and walking on walls. Ian was getting more and more amazed, but not Louise. She was in shock and filled with nervousness over everything that was going on. Slowly they walked along the place until they came to a large glass wall. Moments later, two large creatures came closer to the glass wall. This is the first time we are shown the alien form. Scientists agreed to call them heptapod, a word taken from the Greek, which means hepta is seven and pod is feet, based on their physical form. Colonel Weber asked Louise to start the session immediately, but at that time Louise had not been able to control herself from being nervous after everything she saw. The first session ended without any interaction. Weber asked Louise to immediately prepare a method that she would apply in her next interaction session with the heptapod. Throughout the night, Louise continued to analyze the sound recordings from the previous session. Also think about what method is most effective to communicate with the heptapods. Meanwhile, the news media reported that there had been various cases of riots and looting in several countries due to the economic crisis since the planes landed on Earth. This was exacerbated by statements from representatives from 144 religious forums, which said that the arrival of alien beings to Earth is a sign of prophecies about doomsday. China, through its representative General Zheng, stated that he would strengthen their defense. This was followed by four of its allies. Louise and Ian began their interaction with the heptapod. She broke a board, tried a visual approach to open the possibility of a visual communication basis for heptapods. Louise started her session. She wrote the word human as an attempt to introduce herself. However, they did not receive any interaction response from the two heptapods. Louise took a few steps closer to them. Once again, she tried to introduce herself. Then, an amazing thing happened.
I'm human. What are you?
Yes, they have that. A visual way of communicating. Their writing is circular, non-linear, which looks more like a symbol than the Latin script that humans generally use. Although what Heptapod wrote at that time could not be interpreted by Louise and Ian et al., for them it was a big progress for this research. Namely the disclosure of one way for the Heptapods to communicate. Louise and her team analyzed the symbols that Heptapods made and whether their meanings were related to the word human that she wrote on the board. 18 hours have passed since their last session. Now it's time to get ready for the next session. We will check Louise's report on the method she would use in the next interaction session. Reading it, Weber was surprised. He thought this was ridiculous. She taught the Heptapods to read Louise and Ian's names and introduced them to simple words like elementary school lessons. Louise explained it was meant for them to be able to tell their names, then introduce pronouns. Because to make them understand our main question is, what is your purpose on Earth? They must first need to understand the sentence of the question. Something we humans do to dig for information. Then we must also clarify the difference between the word you for individuals or for groups. Since we want not only one Heptapod reason to come here, but also each of them. Weber was silent and accepted the explanation. The third interaction session started. Louise and Ian applied the method they had created. However, Heptapod's response did not seem positive. Ian felt that they had become confused and did not understand what they meant. According to Louise, the hazmat they use hinders the effectiveness of this interaction. Heptapods have to see their true form to recognize them. Soon Louise let go of her hazmat and walked closer to the Heptapod. Ian was surprised by Louise's bold action, soon took off the hazmat he was wearing. Then they continued the interaction without using hazmat anymore. The session went smoothly and lived up to their expectations. Louise and Ian named the two Heptapods, Abbott and Costello respectively. The third session ended and they returned to the research camp. Upon their return, Louise felt so exhausted. She kept getting images that were like dreams and memories. They were asked to go to the health department to undergo the examination process, the possibility of exposure to radiation or other risky things.
No radiation. Nothing else we can detect either, but I'd give them a strong cocktail regardless.
Throughout the research process, the imagery memories were getting more intense by the day Louise experienced. She told Ian the condition. Louise said that she was experiencing a situation that she didn't know how to explain. Ian guessed that maybe it was because Louise was in the middle of learning a new language. Based on the book he had read, there was a hypothesis that when you learn a new language, the nerves in your brain are reconnected. The language you convey determines the way you think and influences your point of view. The next morning, Weber got word that China was preparing its troops. This is due to the translation of the heptapod symbol, which is believed to have the meaning of a weapon.
China no longer trusts the aliens who want to divide us. Humanity must be protected.
Hearing this news, Louise and Ian try to get back to Abbott and Costello. This time they immediately ask the main question. Here Louise got a similar answer, but Louise was sure that the heptapods meant the word weapon wasn't that simple. Therefore, in the next session, they again ask to make sure of what weapons they referred to.
What does it say?
Offer weapon. We don't know if they understand the difference between a weapon and a tool.
Complicated than that.
How is it more complicated than that?
It's all what they wrote.
Using a word they don't fully understand.
Suddenly, an alarm goes informing that China and Russia have disconnected their virtual communications. They have no withdrawn, which means they will no longer share information about heptapods. This triggered other countries to take similar action. Agent David has directed orders to disband the entire American research team. Even though America has not declared war yet, but America must immediately prepare if there is counterattack from the heptapod. Meanwhile, Louise couldn't let the war that had occurred due to misunderstanding. She attempted to return to the heptapod to detail the question about the weapon. This time they got some words related to technology, tools, and methods. Several times Abbott tapped on the glass wall, signaling to Louise, asking her to try writing the heptapod symbol directly on the glass wall.
What's he doing?
It wasn't long before the sound of gunshots came from outside, which made Costello panic and spit out a lot of black liquid. Suddenly, Louise and Ian were turned out, then an explosion occurred. Sometime later, Louise woke up from fainting due to the explosion. The research team reported that the explosion was the work of one of the soldiers who was influenced by media coverage. Louise suddenly felt something calling her. She exits the camp and finds a capsule, which the heptapod sent to pick up Louise. Inside the spaceship, Louise meets Costello, now they're face to face without any barriers. Costello explains that Abbott was dying from a bomb explosion some time ago. He also explains that their purpose here is to offer a technology which will help human civilization for 3,000 years. But in the future, they will need the help of humans. Louise questioned what analogy that Costello mean. Costello explained that Louise had felt it without her knowing, which is the ability to see the future. Therefore, the heptapods needs Louise's help to convince the humans that they have good intentions. After knowing everything, Louise was picked up by Ian and Weber. Weber explains that they will all be evacuated soon, because Russia has joined forces with China to attack the heptapods. After dropping Louise, all the heptapod planes simultaneously shifted their positions horizontally, as if preparing themselves for the attack they were about to face. At camp, Louise looked for a way to resolve this misunderstanding. In the middle of thinking process, the memory images kept popping up, as if giving a sense of what she should do. In her mind, she was attending a large event a meeting of world leaders held in China.
Dr. Banks, a pleasure.
18 months ago, you did something remarkable.
Do not claim to know how your mind works, but...
What's that?
You changed my mind, all because you reached out to me on my private number.
After that, General Zhang immediately gave his personal number. In the control room, a soldier reported to Agent David that someone else was using his satellite phone and calling China. David immediately ordered the troops to find the location of the phone. Then they found Louise was using it. Sun Yan came and tried to protect Louise. Then Louise spoke the last words of General Zhang's wife, which immediately stopped China's attack on the heptapods. General Zhang's wife's last words were, "War doesn't make winners, only widows." The story closes by showing all the heptapod plants leaving Earth. The end of the story, we are also shown that Louise's future husband will be none other than Ian. At the same time, it explains the image of her doctor at the beginning of the story, which is Anna, is her memory in the future. So Louise already knew everything that would happen in the future in her life. She already knows who she'll marry, why she got divorced, and how the child she loved the most will die of an illness. If you were given such an ability, where you already know the entire destiny of your life, what would you do?